Watch Infra TV, your digital economic channel on power, energy and infrastructure. Promoter Inertia Infra Media. Contact A. Prakash Iyer, Executive Editor on 0251-6500533. Mobile 0922-354-7582. 0932260-4411. Email infratv.eepl@gmail.com.
Inertia and REPA jointly present Professor Iyer's talk show, Future of Energy, India Vision 2022. India's first talk show on energy and power. Exclusively on Zee Business. Co-partners MTU On-Site Energy and BS Group Sugan Automatics. Associate partner BHEL. Supported by Jindal Power Limited and Patel Engineering Limited. Segment partner Green Brilliance Energy. A Falcon Media production exclusively on Zee Business.
Welcome viewers to this exclusive show, Future of Energy, India Vision 2022. And we have the episode 2 on renewable energy for you. With me today on this dais are an excellent panel, and leading the panel is Sri Anil Razdan, former Secretary Power, Government of India. And I must say that he was also responsible for a lot of movement in the National Solar Mission. On my right is Mr. Surendra Nagila, who is the Managing Director and CEO of Sugan Automatics. And on my right of him is Mr. Rajiv Kumar Srivastava, the former ED BHEL, who moved the entire solar manufacturing at BHEL and now heads SuCam Power System as the Director. On my left after Mr. Razdan, an eminent personality, our friend from Germany and Europe, and a man who has seen the world, Mr. Dr. Hitesh Khanna, Director of Business Strategy for MTU On-Site Energy, Germany. On my extreme left is Sri T.C. Arora, the Managing Director of Visa PowerTech Limited and also the former Director of Toshiba India. And on my extreme right is a very important guest who has joined us, who is also my colleague and the Joint President of REPA, Renewable Energy Promotion Association, an association formed to promote renewable energy in India. Welcome all of you. And to begin this session, let me first put up the question to Razdan Saab. So Razdan Saab, how do we see that India achieves a 40 to 50 gigawatt kind of a target?
We've got to innovate technology, we've got to encourage development of new technology. And I would say that it's like a gold rush. Whoever reaches there first and fastest should get the best rewards. I would not be opposed to the idea of announcing a large grant for whoever develops viable solar commercial technology at a tariff, say, it used to talk 10 rupees. I'd say today the barrier should be put at about 6 rupees or something, so that we bring it as close as possible to the other grid power in the years to come. And I think we have solar PV at the moment. The tariffs have come down to 7.5 rupees. We need to work very hard on concentrated solar, and I think we have eminent players around us who will be willing to say that yes, concentrated solar can come down to tariffs of maybe 6 or 5 rupees in the years to come.
So, as you rightly have said on the PV, now taking that entire argument, and you said that even the concentrated solar can come. May I put that question off straight away by jumping into Rajiv Srivastava Saab? Sure. May I have your views on this issue?
Well, CSP definitely has very good potential, and the reason being that it's large. The only issue that could come in the way of CSP is the fact that it requires a certain amount of water. And but for water coming in the way as it does in the state of Gujarat, Rajasthan is a place which has got almost 80% of all the CSPs. So I do consider CSP as a very high growth area, and I agree with the national objective of placing 50% of the trust on photovoltaic and the other 50% on CSP.
Arora Saab, do we really see it will be 50-50, or we'll see more of PV coming in the next?
The initial years there could be more PV because it's faster. And as far as the CSP is concerned, the two technologies are there which has been commercially proven. One is the Fresnel, another is parabolic. The dish and tower are still at initial stages, and the capacity limitation is there. The advantage is that For CSP, most of the material can be localized, and that will, over the period, will take over the PV.
What do you think, Mehta sir, how does a successful model like Gujarat and maybe in the future Rajasthan give a hope for India to expand that capacity to what we discussed, 40-50 gigawatt?
See, Gujarat has already started the implementation and the first plant is already dedicated to Nishan at Patan. And what you are talking is the future. Future is absolutely bright for the solar, particularly in the Gujarat region. All technologies is available, all manpower is available, all people are ready to push it. But only the thing we need is the synchronization in the process, that it has to be concentrated and synchronized in the proper way that we can achieve this 40 gigawatt target. And definitely Gujarat will take lead in that case.
I address this question to Surendra Nagila ji. Do you think that we should not have such a skewed development model where only we see two states or a couple of states out of 30 states only going towards solar? Is there potential to expand like the central and southern states, maybe Karnataka, maybe Maharashtra, a little bit of Haryana, you know? Shouldn't the solar strategy spread across the country rather than have just a few states making the hay while the sun shines?
The reason being there's more proactive governments, and the land use and land cover issues has given birth to this type of capacity addition in these two states. But I think nevertheless, other states are also catching up. And as we discuss, the question here is, in certain areas where you don't have that much of a concentration, and wherever you have the cover right from morning 6 o'clock to evening 6 o'clock, there are a lot of lab models and technologies that have come up in a big way to bring in this efficiency of the panel. Today we are bringing it around 25% of the installed capacity as a solar available. But going forward, we may look at 40% and 50% harnessing of the same panels what we are using it for, one-fourth of the capacity. Once that is commercialized, I think every state with that type of a grant, what I'll totally agree with Rajanji, that this is the way we have to really take it forward in other states. Because the availability of power morning to 6 to evening 6, the efficiency, the total system efficiency, not only as a solar panel efficiency, will give birth to this type of states coming forward, and they will fulfill the objective of what you are envisioning.
Right. So we come back to you after a very short break just to discuss back how do we go to that 40 to 50 gigawatt target for solar load, and also in the renewable portfolio, how to develop a 100 gigawatt plan and execute it over the next two decades, you know. Coming back to you after a short break. Welcome back after the break, and in this segment we will discuss, can India really go to a superpower status in solar and maybe other renewables?
Okay, so I have a question here, Khanna sir. See, almost like all of these renewables, whether it's solar or wind, are basically solid state energies, you know. I meant to say there is no way we can store at this point. The energy has to be taken away. So in that kind of a challenge, you know, you must have seen in Europe. Europe, of course, has a little disadvantage in the sense that they have more of the winter season. But in India, we have at least 320 shining days minimum, you know, across the country. So how do you see this situation? Is it a good time for India, even with the lack of storage technology, to put as much renewables into the grid?
Professor, this is a very interesting thought which you have brought into the whole picture, because if you are looking at optimization, utilization of the resources today, and how to conserve those resources, this is something, you know, which technology is still working on it. There are some solutions where we can store energy through water by pumping up the water levels, or we have the salt storages. Then we are talking about new technologies as far as the battery developments are concerned. We are looking at the future of lithium batteries, you know, which will be storing capacity. So the question of the day and night and wind is another thing, because if there's wind, you have power. If you don't have wind, you don't have power, actually, you see. So sun limitations, we are lucky in this country to have a lot of sun. One has to utilize it intelligently and see the solutions are provided there. technology is working on it.
You know, coming back and taking back from where we left, you know, what is it that we must do, you know, to make that 100 gigawatt feasible? What are the 1, 2, 3 steps that we need to take? For example, financing. For example, making available finance to the renewable industry. For example, getting the best technologies into the country, making technology investment attractive. What in your view could be the ways out?
I think the first and foremost is that we've made a beginning already. That incentives must be based on generation and not on your capital outlay. We're interested in the final results. There is a development phase, and I think there are large players like BHEL, NTPC, who have surpluses also, who can probably be induced to get into these research areas. R&D is certainly not what it ought to be in Indian industry today. It is very, very low. We need to develop these new areas, we need big industry to back it up. Of course, we have foreign players also who are interested. We should encourage them. I think when we are talking of foreign direct investment country in the country, I think we should encourage it in these priority areas. That these are the areas we need to come. There is to be concessional finance, but as I mentioned earlier on, I think the big prize, the big money is to whoever is provides the cost breakthrough at a certain difficult barrier that we create, because that will be the real game changer.
Right. So taking a cue from there, I would go to Arora Saab, who has seen a lot of solar development and has been at the forefront of it, both in Rajasthan and Gujarat. You know, is it really feasible that we look at 5 rupees per unit power from solar, especially from the PV, let's say?
The experience says that yes, because we started with 18 rupees and we've reached 7.5 rupees in a span of 2 years. And we talk about another 5 years or 4 years, it's possible. But that, as Mr. Rajan said, we need to have technologies R&D developed here. We can't be doing only 25-30% value addition in the country and import. We have a lot of sand available which can be converted into silicon. Why don't we start from the backward and forward integration? And that is from the sand to silicon, silicon to wafers, wafers to cells, cells to modules. So that value addition, if it comes, it will bring down the cost drastically. Although internationally the capacities have been built up, that's why the prices have gone down. But when it is domestically produced, then we don't have this risk of exchange rate or interest rate. That will also bring down the cost.
I would now put this question to Dr. Khanna. We see in Germany and predominantly a lot of Europe, especially Germany, leading through the rooftop strategy, you know, a lot of rooftop power, two-way supply, and most homes are generating homes rather than consuming, earning money and currency. Is such a situation more feasible in India with the rural integration and I would say the rural rooftops coming onto the grid and maybe use even a combined hybrid strategy of putting some wind energy into it?
As far as India is concerned, I certainly see a lot of potential there provided the financing model is sustainable actually. So it's a very interesting aspect. I'll give you an example. For instance, if we could have a sort of a public-private partnership in a financing model, for instance, typically for Germany, the German insurance companies, insurance agents have been selling PV rooftop models as an investment for the future and for their pension schemes, for instance, you see, with a return of 8 to 10%. As in the, which you could see as their old age pension, you know, so on, guaranteed for 20 years. So everybody was interested to put rooftop models. One advantage was becoming independent from the electrical grid. Second benefit was to supply power to the electrical grid. And third was naturally to use captive power for your own use, actually, you see. So it's that sort of a combination could be a motivation factor, and with such a big economy over here, I think it could be one of the fastest drivers, growth drivers to promote solar and PV business in this country and bring in power to the grid or to the rural areas, so that people can certainly utilize electricity and fulfill their basic needs over here. So I think It's a very good idea if you can do that, Jason.
Next session will come after this, right after this break. Welcome after the break on this exclusive episode on renewable energy on Zee Business, Future of Energy India Vision, the Inertia Show. When our first stop is Zardar Saab, you know, India was a leader in the wind energy segment some time back until we were taken over by China about a couple of years back. It was just about 1.5 years back. So why we lost that leadership in a similar state, you know, we see suddenly we are having a lot of interest in solar and what is the step that we should take that we should not leave that leadership?
Well, I think you see, Indian minds are innovative, but I think somewhere in our system we lack the determination to sustain and remain at the vanguard of things. We have a very glorious past, we've had islands of excellence, but as a system, I think, you know, some of these totalitarian regimes, of course, they decide to do a thing and they go whole hog for it, whether it is arranging an Olympics or going in for a particular mission. We certainly cannot have that kind of a mindset. But I think in our country, we need to develop a mindset that yes, this job has to be done. There's no excuse for not doing it. I think we've got to develop a culture if we want to compete with China or other countries, Germany, etc. A culture of performance, rather than a culture of finding faults.
Okay. I want to ask Khanna Saab in this, you know, what happened to the feed-in tariff regime? In Germany it's collapsed, you know, and we almost in India began with the same FID. Shouldn't we do away and give direct incentive to manufacturing and to encourage the green, non-carbon based, I would say, power generation? Maybe even tax carbon power generation as a devil's advocate?
Feed-in tariffs in the solar area were very high originally when this EV industry started, but the cost of production was also very high. So to be successful and to have a commercialization of the solar industry, there had to be certain incentives, and these incentives were given by the German government and other countries also. Today the cost of production has come down a lot. Subsidization is always not a very intelligent way of promoting an industry. So I personally think, because that means you are shifting your economical budgets from one side to the other side and offsetting certain balancing acts into the budget itself. So with the tariff structure today, solar or PV industry is becoming very competitive. So those feed-in tariffs could be one way of looking at it, but optimizing those feed-in tariffs in relation to the cost of production. But otherwise, it won't work.
There is now one major point which I need to address, and I think Shiraso Saab will throw light on it. We have seen that Europe has also accepted the first solar, you know, it is the most competitive company, but came with cadmium telluride. And we are seeing pollution also becoming a subject in the solar industry.
Definitely on cadmium telluride, I do feel and share your views entirely. For two reasons, as you rightly said, it does not encourage competition because it's a technology which is held by just one company and very close to their chest. And number two, there are issues of pollution, disposal of the end product after use. And thirdly, the elements which are used in cadmium telluride are also rare and have only a very finite availability on the planet.
I address this absolutely to wind up. We have very less time for the session. May I request others to just address, to become a superpower in renewable energy, should we strengthen our fundamental education system? For example, the NITs, the IITs and the leading engineering colleges, shouldn't they introduce specific engineering programs on renewable energy? IT has introduced renewable energy training. Why become plumber, fitters? Why not take one area of power in the area of, I would say, maybe panel assemblers?
See, I I entirely agree with you. So whichever state or region takes up a certain, a state or regional plan, it has to be an integrated plan which provides the capacity building, that's manpower, maintenance, the raw material chain, development of technology, but at least the integration of the local grids to carry that kind of power, the capability of your appliances, devices to match that kind of power. Because you see, there is a great advantage in decentralized power if we can develop it. In fact, that in my vision is the vision of the future, that each home or unit should be independent, maybe someday to carry on its own functions. Because what is the advantage of the petrol or liquid fuels? That you can carry them anywhere. If you can make these decentralized sources of energy make the human being more independent, but you have to provide him with technology which he's got used to for carrying out his functions, which can enable him to become independent, you are saving this huge jungle of transmission and distribution. These very large chains and companies, where if one goes broke on the way, the whole system has to suffer. If one set of consumers is not paying their bills, the other consumer gets the power break, things like that. We have to concentrate on this decentralized power, decentralized sources of power. You've got to create those whole systems to be able to sustain them, technology to sustain them, and the people also. But it has to be done in an integrated fashion, because otherwise these youth, if that solar power doesn't develop in that fashion in that area, they will not know what to do thereafter.
Right. So with that view, we come to the fag end of this session, and as Rajdhan sir rightly said, we'll further discuss in our next episode decentralized and distributed power generation, maybe going towards other aspects like gas-based generation in a bigger way. And we will return with our next episode. Till then, goodbye viewers, and thanks all our guests here for the day.
Inertia and REPA jointly present Professor Iyer's talk show, Future of Energy, India Vision 2022. India's first talk show on energy and power. Exclusively on Zee Business. Co-partners MTU On-Site Energy and BS Group Sugan Automatics. Associate partner BHEL. Supported by Jindal Power Limited and Patel Engineering Limited. Segment partner Green Brilliance Energy. A Falcon Media production exclusively on Zee Business.
If you are a power, energy and infrastructure company, advertise and promote your brand with India's topmost international grade publications. Inertia, Asia's premier journal on sustainable energy and power. And Markonomy, the journal for infrastructure, water, environment and economy. Also presenting Markonomy Marathi, India's first and only regional language journal on energy, power and infrastructure sectors. Power your brands, advertise with our journals, partner our seminars and roundtables. Supported by Inertia Foundation and REPA, Renewable Energy Promotion Association. Contact Falcon Media, email inertia.falcon@gmail.com, markonomy.falcon@gmail.com, call 0902-907-7245, 0902-909-2223, 0922-354-7582.